Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Our next section is Build Your First Cyber Forensic Application Using Python, presented by Dr. Gajendra. Let's welcome Dr. Gajendra.
Hello, everyone. My name is Gajendra Deshpande, and today I will be presenting a talk on Build Your First Cyber Forensic Application Using Python. So in my talk, I'll be discussing about introduction to digital crimes, digital forensics, the process of investigation and the collection of evidence, then setting up Python for forensic application development, built-in functions and modules for forensic tasks, forensic indexing and searching, hash functions for forensics, forensic evidence extraction, then metadata forensics, then using natural language tools for forensic purpose. Let us first see some statistics related to the cybercrime. The Internet Crime Report for 2019, released by USA's Internet Crime Complaint Center, IC3, of the Federal Bureau of Investigation, has revealed top four countries that are victims of internet crimes. So, first one being the US, where more than 460,000 crimes have been reported, then followed by UK, where more than 90,000, Canada, more than 30,000, and India, more than 25,000. Of course, these are only the reported numbers, but unreported numbers can be much higher. Then, according to RSA report of 2015, mobile transactions are rapidly growing and cyber criminals are migrating to less protected soft channels. So mobiles are considered as soft channels because most of the people use them, but they are not aware of the various security settings available in those devices. So according to the report by Norton, an estimated 103 million Indians lost about 16,558 rupees on an average to cybercrime. So that's roughly around more than $200. So according to an article published in Indian Express on 19th November 2016, over 55% of millennials in India are hit by the cybercrime. And a recent study by the Checkpoint Research has recorded over more than 150,000 cyber attacks every week during the COVID-19 pandemic. So there has been an increase of 30,000. There has been an increase of 30% in cyber attacks compared to the previous weeks. Now let us discuss some basics related to digital forensics. So first let us define the forensic science. So it's the use of scientific methods or expertise to investigate crimes or examine evidence that might be presented in a court of law. Then cyber forensics is investigation of various crimes happening in the cyberspace. So examples of cyber attacks include phishing, ransomware, fake news, fake medicine, extortion, and also the insider frauds. So insider frauds are also very important because there may be many people, especially in the period of pandemic, those who have lost jobs, those who are not satisfied in their jobs. So they may easily turn into insider attackers. And according to DFRWS, that is Digital Forensics Research Workshop, the digital forensics can be defined as the use of scientifically derived and proven method toward the preservation, collection, validation, identification, analysis, interpretation, documentation, and presentation of digital evidence derived from the digital sources for the purpose of facilitating and furthering the reconstruction of events found to be criminal, or helping to anticipate unauthorized actions shown to be disruptive to the planned operations. So if you have a look at this definition, then there are two parts. The first part tells us the various steps involved in the digital forensics investigation, and second one focuses on reconstruction of the events such that evidence can be determined and it can be presented in the court of law. Now, the digital forensic investigation process involves six steps. So first one is identification. In identification, what happens is the investigation officer visits the crime location and he or she is going to identify the various objects so that they can seize them. So once they identify these objects, they can they are going to collect them, and when they are collecting those documents or those objects, they have to store it in proper bags, such as say for example anti-static bags or Faraday bags needs to be used. And when they're collecting the object, they need to see that they collect all the objects. Sometimes it also happens that there may be pen drives which are in the form of toys and they may be left out. So even such things needs to be closely identified and collected. The next one is the validation. Now what happens in validation is that many times data will be copied from the systems. Now when they copy the data, they need to ensure that that data is not changed. So for that, various techniques are used, and one of them is hashing, which is used for integrity checks. Then the fourth step is the examination. So there are various tools. The investigative officer can use the ready-made tools, or they can develop their own tools if they have time, using the language such as Python, and they can examine the data. And even the data analysis techniques such as machine learning algorithms can also be used for identifying the evidence or to get the more insights regarding the clues. The next is preservation. Now note here that whatever objects are collected, whatever data is collected, it needs to be stored in a proper place, in a lockers. And when they are storing in lockers, they need to ensure that proper security is given to the data, and they also need to ensure that a proper room temperature needs to be maintained. Otherwise the data may be lost from the hard disks. So that's a very serious issue. So they need to ensure that the data they collect is preserved. Then finally, which is very, very important, that is the presentation aspect. And note here that there will be a standard procedure laid out by the law enforcement agencies, and that procedure needs to be strictly followed whenever they are performing above 5 steps. So if they are not following, if something is lacking, then that may not be considered as an evidence and court may not accept it. So it is very important to follow the standard procedure laid out by the law enforcement agencies. Now there is a standard called as Daubert standard. So let's see what is Daubert standard and what is its relation to Python, or maybe in general with the open source software. So in United States federal law, the Daubert standard is a rule of evidence regarding the admissibility of expert witness testimony. So a party may raise a Daubert motion, a special motion in limine raised before or during trial, to exclude the presentation of unqualified evidence to the jury. So illustrative factors: the court defined the scientific methodology as the process of formulating hypothesis and then conducting experiments to prove or falsify the hypothesis, and provided a set of illustrative factors. So these illustrative factors are: has the technique been tested in actual field conditions and not just in a laboratory? Has the technique been subject to peer review and publication? What is the known or potential rate of error? Do standards exist for the control of technique's operation? Has the technique been generally accepted within the relevant scientific community? So in 2003, Brian Carrier published a paper that examined the rules of evidence standards, including Daubert, and compared and contrasted the open source and closed source forensic tools. So one of his key conclusions was: using the guidelines of the Daubert tests, we have shown that open source tools may more clearly and comprehensively meet the guideline requirements than would closed source tools. So since Python is a open source tool, so it clearly satisfies the statement given by the Brian Carrier, and thus Python can be used in forensic tool development. Then the results are not automatic, of course, so just because the source is open. So rather, specific steps must be followed regarding design, development and validation. So those steps include: can the program or algorithm be explained? The explanation should be explained in words, not only in code. Has the enough information been provided such that thorough tests can be developed to test the program? Have error rates been calculated and validated independently? Has the program been studied and peer reviewed? Has the program been generally accepted by the community? So these are the steps which are mentioned in the book, with titled Python Forensics by Jed Osmer, so you can refer it for more details. The next is setting up Python for forensic application development. So there are various factors which you need to consider whenever you are setting up a Python environment for developing the forensic applications. So first one is your background and organization support. So for example, are you good at open source tools, developing open source tools and contributing to open source projects? Whether your organization supports it or is it just uses the proprietary tools and it has enough money to buy the proprietary tools. Then choosing the third party libraries, it can be a little bit risky because some of the libraries may be outdated. Then next is IDEs and their features. So it is better to use integrated development environments and their features for writing the code. It can save a lot of time. The next is installation. So it depends on you whether you want to install these tools on a standalone operating system or you want to use virtual machines or you want to use cloud-based tools. The next is write version of Python. Now say for example when you are using the third party libraries, as we have discussed, that some of the libraries may not be maintained for a longer time and they work only with the specific version of Python. So in that case it becomes very important for us to use the right version of Python. The next is graphical versus shell. So many times if you are a beginner you prefer to use graphical tools, but if you are a geek, if you are a very experienced person and if you love command line interface, then you obviously choose for shell. Now let us see some built-in functions and modules which can be used to build a simple cyber forensic application. Now when you type this command dir built-ins, it's going to list the built-in functions in Python. Now from this list we are going to use few functions such as range for our forensic purpose. Now in this code you can see here that we have defined the base address, which is nothing but the local address. Then we have specified range as 10, that means I want to generate 10 IP addresses. So in this case you can generate any number of IP addresses, and for that purpose you can use the built-in function called as range in Python. The next is similarly you can use OS module. So if you want to list or if you want to deal with the files and directories in your machine, then you can just write a small simple code. So import the OS library, then use the getcwd function, then use this dir method and just print the files and folders in that particular path. So of course this is a very simple application, but we are going to write, or you need to write, complicated applications using these simple modules. Now next one is forensic indexing and searching. So you can use simple file search and index function. Now say for example what is happening here is we have used a key, we have used a variable called as search words and we are creating a empty set. Then we are opening a file called as keywords.txt. Then for every line, that is for every word in the file, we are removing the empty spaces. Then we are printing these search words, so in the form of set. Then we are searching whether the Python is present in the search words set. If it is present, then we say that word found, otherwise not found. It may look that it's a very simple application, but this can be, or its extended version can be used to find out the relevant information in forensic application. Generally, note here that we need to perform search application on a very large data. It will be in the form of gigabytes. So in that case, you can also go for a Python package called as Hoosh. So it's a basically forensic indexing and searching tool. So it was created and is maintained by Matt, and it was originally created for use in the online help system of Side Effects software's 3D animation software called as Houdini. So it's a pure Python library and it supports Pythonic API. It basically allows you to create indexes and retrieve the information very quickly. So it has got a very powerful language, and it also supports pluggable scoring algorithms, text analysis, storage, and posting formats, etc. And it also supports pure Python spell checker. Now let us see the source code here. So in first few lines, we are importing the required modules. Then we are creating the index where we are adding the documents. Now once the documents are added, then we are using the query parser module to search for the required content. So if the required content is found, then it means that you have found the evidence. So basically, Whoosh can be used to build the local search engine for a particular data. The next is hash functions. We know that hash functions are used for integrity checks. So here we are writing a very simple application. So we are importing the library called as hashlib. Then we are setting the algorithm, that is SHA-256. Then we are using a variable m, and we are defining we are assigning some content to it. Then we are calculating the digest on the variable m. Then we are defining the next variable called as x. Then again we are computing the digest on x. Then we are checking whether the m's digest is equal to x digest. So in this case it says that it's true because both the sentences are same. Now in the next case, what I have done is I have added one extra space at the end of variable x's content. Now in this case, when I compare the digests of variable m and variable x, it says that it false. That's because I have modified the content. So this is how you can use hash functions to check whether the data has been modified. The next is forensic evidence extraction. So for that, we are going to use some packages known as Pillow. So it's a Pillow is the friendly PIL fork by Alex Clark and contributors. It is the Python imaging library. So it adds image processing capabilities to the Python interpreter, and it supports various extensive file formats and very efficient. Now this is how we can use this PIL library to extract the tags of a file. So in the first part, you can see here that we are importing exif tags, and it returns the various files properties related to the files, such as file name, file size, when it was modified, when it was created, etc., etc. Then similarly, if you want to extract GPS information, such as longitude and latitude and location information, then you need to import GPS tags module. Then similarly, if you want both, then you can use both, and you can compute it for a particular image. Then the next package is the PyScreenshot. So it tries to allow to take screenshots without installing the third-party libraries. It is cross-platform but mainly useful for Linux-based distributions. So it's a cross-platform wrapper, and it can capture the whole of desktop or a part of a screen. Now important thing here is that performance is not the target for this library, because extracting evidence is important and not the speed or the performance. Now this is how you can take the screenshot of the entire screen. So for that you need to import PyScreenshot module, then use the grab method and use the save method to specify the file name. Now you can also take the screenshot of a part of a screen. So in this case, you need to specify the x1, y1 and x2, y2 coordinates. So in this case, it will take the screenshot of the specified coordinates on a screen. Now you can also see here that if you, those who are really interested in performance, in that case, say for example, if you have got TBs of data, lots of data to analyze, so in that case, you can go for such examples. So in this case, you can see here that there are various packages and their performance is specified, and you can select the one with the less value. Okay, so now you can also improve the performance by setting the child process as 0. And there is one more way to improve the performance, that is specify up or force a particular module as the backend. So for example, you can force Scrot as the backend, and you can also force maybe backend as MSS and the child process as false. So this is going to give you the best performance. The next is the metadata forensics. So for metadata forensics, we are going to use various packages depending on the file type and the type of data. Now say for example, if you want to extract the information from audio file, then you are going to use Mutagen Python module. So it supports various extensions such as MP4, Ogg Vorbis, and so on. So again, it works with Python 3.6 plus on Linux, Windows, and Mac OS, and has got no dependencies outside Python standard library. Now in this screen, you can see here that this is how you can install the Mutagen module. So many people are aware of this syntax. So that is pip install mutagen. Then the code mentioned on the screen, what it does is it takes any audio file and try to guess its type, and it returns a file type if it is found. Otherwise, it returns no value. So in this case, it has said that the file type is Ogg Vorbis and the duration is 346.43 seconds and 499821 is the bits per second. Then similarly, you can also work with different files such as FLAC file and MP3 file, and you can get its properties. The next is the PyPDF2 module. It's again a pure Python library. So it's built as a PDF toolkit, and it is capable of extracting document information such as title, author, file size, etc. So you can split documents page by page, you can merge documents page by page, you can crop the pages, then you can merge multiple pages into single page. Then encrypting and decrypting of PDF files is possible, and it is very useful tool for websites that manage or manipulate PDFs. The next is the pfile module. It's a multi-platform Python module to parse and work with portable executable files. But note here that portable executable files are mostly related to the Windows operating system. But you can analyze and you can get the information on any platform. So the structure defined in the Windows header files will be accessible as attributes in the PE instance. The naming of fields or attributes will try to adhere to the naming scheme in those headers. So only shortcuts added for convenience will depart from that convention. So PE file requires some basic understanding of the layout of a PE file. With it, it's possible to explore nearly every single feature of the PE file format. So some tasks which are possible from PE file module are that you can inspect headers, analyze the sections data, you can retrieve embedded data, reading strings from resources, you can generate warnings for suspicious and malformed values, and so on. The next one is using natural language tools for analysis purpose. So you can examine the text for evidence using NLP concepts. So for that, you can use various packages such as NLTK, SPACY, and TextSE. So SPACY is the industry standard tool for natural language processing. TextSE is built on top of SPACY. Now they also support some languages such as the Spanish and others. But so mostly Western languages are supported. But if you are interested in more languages, then you can explore Stanza and Polyglot. So Stanza is a library from Stanford University, which supports almost 60 plus human languages. And Polyglot also supports more than 150 languages, but not all features are supported by both of these libraries. So some features are supported only for some languages. Okay, so there is a lot of scope if you want to contribute to these packages. Then if you are really interested only in Indian languages, then you can go for INLTK and Indic NLP packages. Now I would like to discuss about something called as dark data. So what companies do is they collect more data than required, and they don't analyze everything, but most of this data is required only for the compliance purpose, and whenever a crime happens, this data may be very useful. So in case of dark data analytics, you can go for natural language tools to identify the evidence. So in summary, it is very important to follow the standard procedure laid by law enforcement agencies during investigation process. Then there are many open source as well as commercial tools for digital processing, digital forensics. We know that using open source tools satisfies the open source tools satisfy the Dauber standard than the commercial tools. So learning to develop your own tool is always advantageous because you can always save money and also improve your coding skills. Many tools written in Python are pure Python implementations, and most importantly, Python and open source tools comply with Dauber standard. So thank you everyone for attending my talk.